Are you looking for security architect interview questions and cloud security architect interview questions? If so, this video is for you. In this video, we're going to go over the types of questions we managers typically ask security architects and the kind of answers we're looking for. To see if the person has the ability to be an architect. We're going to be looking for the way the person explains things. Can they explain things at an executive level? Do they also have the competency? And this is going to be one of a series of videos on security architect interview questions and cloud security architect interview questions, because I want you to get hired on your next security architect interview. And after conducting thousands of interviews, I find that many people have a challenge answering architectural questions, especially for network architect interviews and cloud architect interviews and security architect interviews. So this will be a series of a few videos. In this video, I'm going to cover 5 interview questions, and I'm going to give you the kind of answers that I would typically look for in a person that I'm going to hire. The first question I would ask a security architect is, what are the key components of a robust security framework? And I want them to be able to explain that it includes something like governance and risk management, whether that be creating a policy or a standard or procedure to reduce risk, some form of asset and data protection, where they're going to be identifying and safeguarding critical assets, some form of identity and access management, the authentication being determining who you are, the authorization being what you're allowed to do, and the accounting being what you've actually done. There's usually some component of network security, and this is pretty substantial, because here's where we have things like access control as firewalls, intrusion detection, intrusion prevention, and we can segment our environments. There's typically some form of application security that needs to be there, meaning the way the software is developed and does it have application security features like input validation, et cetera? Are the applications patched? Those types of things. And there's usually some form of incident response in a good security framework, something that would say, you know, what do we do in an incident, who responds, and how we do it. There's typically some form of compliance and auditing in any good security architecture, and there typically needs to be some form of security awareness and training of the security personnel, but also the employees of the organization. So that's the kind of answer I'm looking for from a security architect on what are the key components of a robust security framework. Now, I might also ask someone a more technical question and say, how would you ensure the security of APIs and microservices? Now, look, I'm not looking for a security engineering answer. I'm looking for an architecture answer, which again is going to be a bit high level. So I'm going to look for the person to say, well, how do we ensure the security of our APIs? It's going to take a multi-pronged approach. For example, we'll want to use some form of robust authentication and authorization. Maybe we use something like an OAuth2 token or a Java web token, something that's going to be strong, along with some form of role-based access control. Now, we want to make sure we have some form of input validation and sanitation so people can't put in bad information. So we want to protect against that. We want to make sure we use some form of secure communication, so something like TLS encryption. You know, we may want to protect the API itself. We may want to use an API gateway to centralize security policy, say monitor traffic, and a rate limit the request to an API. And we're going to want to continually test and audit our systems to make sure that they're secure. And we'll want to make sure that we micro-segment our environment, meaning making sure certain systems can't talk to other systems. And of course, we're going to want to make sure that there's a secure coding process for anything that goes into the APIs. So, you know, those are the kind of things that we're looking for in an answer. And I might ask a question, how do you secure network architectures and infrastructure? And I might do that because networking is a big component, and I want to make sure you have some knowledge of networking. So here's where I'm trying to see what the person knows about networking, because if they do, they'll understand that they can protect perimeters and edges of their systems with things like firewalls. They'll understand intrusion detection, intrusion prevention systems, and next generation firewalls. They'll typically understand things like access control lists and VLANs and limiting routes, so to keep certain parts of the network unreachable, and potentially quality of service and traffic shaping and traffic policing are all things that we could do in network security. So we're looking to see if the person actually understands these things. Now, I often ask people, can you explain the concept of defense in depth? And even if we use zero trust architectures, which I strongly recommend we do, we still need a lot of defense in depth because no one security mechanism is ever going to be enough. So if I ask someone what is defense in depth, what I'm hoping they answer is that it's something that provides layered security and it employs multiple security controls across different layers. For example, an access control as the firewall, an IDS IPS system, IAM, endpoint protection. And the key is we assume that one layer is never going to be enough because it could actually be breached. So we're creating redundancy with defense in depth, offering additional levels, much like an onion. If you peel one layer, there's another layer underneath. And each layer is a layer of defense. Now, we're typically doing something like this. We assume breach, it limits our control. And because we're segmenting and we're using routers and switches and firewalls in between areas, now we can get a lot of information on the traffic that's trying to go back and forth, which can help us detect things that are going wrong. When we start combining IDS, IPS systems and things like SIEM systems and even AI, now we can find out challenges when they're actually occurring and then respond to them. So defense in depth gives us a multi-pronged approach to protect against security incidents. I might also ask the question, what role does zero trust architecture play in modern security architecture and modern cloud security architecture? And I might be asking the question for this reason. I really want to know if the person understands zero trust, but I also want to know if they understand the drivers behind zero trust. Do they understand and can they explain? In the data center, we had very hard boundaries where we had our internal private environment, then we had our firewall, and then we had the internet, and we had all of our web-facing assets in a demilitarized zone outside our protected internal network. And in the modern world with cloud computing, we have much softer boundaries connecting to the internet and much softer perimeters. We also commonly have distributed computing in a wide variety of environments. And as such, we need something stronger. So we solve some of these challenges with zero trust, which works on the premise of never trust and always verify. So in zero trust, no user, no device, or no system is inherently tested. So we have consistent authentication of the devices to make sure they are who they're supposed to be. Now, a good, strong zero trust environment minimizes lateral movement. What I mean by that is it restricts access rights to the minimum necessary for the people to do their job. And by doing so, by enforcing the principle of least privilege, it reduces the potential for attackers to move more freely in the systems. Zero trust provides very good, strong, granular access control, so we can employ strict policies, and we can use more intelligent context-aware policies where we can look at things, not only things like a username and a password or whatever the authentication is, we can also look at, is it the correct device? Is the device that's accessing the system the right device, and is it properly hardened? Is the user coming from the right location, and make decisions based upon risk before providing access? And zero trust really provides for constant monitoring and analytics. You're constantly looking in the environment. You're assuming you're breached, and then you're constantly looking for it, which is a great way to operate. Assume that people already have access to your systems and behave that way. And it's about micro-segmentation. And micro-segmentation is dividing the network into as many small components as we can to reduce the blast radius. If something happens here, it may not affect something else. If this area gets hacked, maybe the attack won't propagate to this area. And we're typically talking about strong encryption with zero trust. So as you can see, zero trust solves the modern challenges of computing, like distributed computing and cloud computing, where we have softer perimeters. Now, like I said, this is the first in a series of security architect and cloud security architect interview videos we're going to make for you. So please subscribe and hit the bell to be notified of those new videos. If you'd like to become a security architect or a cloud architect or an enterprise architect or an AI architect, we have completely free architecture webinars and resources for you to help you in your career. Check them out. They are in the description of this video. If you come to one of our webinars, we'll go over the architect career of your choice, say security architect. We'll talk about what we do. We'll talk about all the skills you need to be a security architect, for example. And then we'll answer any questions that you might want for 60 to 90 minutes live and free on Zoom. So please sign up. The link is in the description of this video, along with those free resources like how to win the interview or how to become a cloud architect. project. They're all there. Check them out and they're all free. And I hope to see you on another video. I really do. I love making these videos and I hope to assist you in your cloud architect career, enterprise architect career, security architect career, or any other architect career you desire.